Thank you all for honoring them in that way. I'm going to pray for the service. I know I just prayed for them. We're going to pray for the service because I got to pray for this guy and pray that God will just do what he does in this house tonight. God, we come before you tonight and we thank you for the honor and the privilege of being here. We thank you for this gift of life that you've given everybody in this room. We thank you, Father, that you challenge us and you call us to lead. We thank you, God, that you challenge us to step out. We thank you, God, that you challenge us to live lives that honor you. And God, I pray that tonight every one of us will, Holy Spirit, allow you to change our hearts, change our minds. God, help us to be better. Help us to be better than we left than we were when we came in. God, show us something. Jesus, reveal something to everyone, including me, starting with me. Show us something tonight, God. God, I pray that there'd be more of you and less of me. That you'd use my words, Father, to bring you honor, to bring you glory. I thank you for the opportunity that you give me to be part of this great, great church body. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. All right. Sorry, I'm going to gross you out. All right, better?
Better.
No more sniffing? All right, I need a show of hands. All right, I want a show of hands. I want you to raise your hand tonight if you just have way too much time on your hands. If you every week just have, at the end of the week, say, man, I don't know what I'm going to do with my time. I've just got so much time to not do anything with. All right, one person. Okay, that was awkward. Way to go. All right. Ruined my whole illustration, the one person. I won't mention Calvin's name because I'm not going to embarrass him. The answer usually to that question is, no, not me. I am always looking for more time. As a matter of fact, the older I get, it seems like time goes by faster. Right? When you're young, it seems like Christmas takes forever to get here. It's like, what? It's only August. I've got all this time left to open presents. It's never going to come, right? And you're 51, you're like, wasn't Christmas yesterday? The heck? Time just seems to skip by. As a matter of fact, oftentimes it seems like time keeps on slipping, slipping. Sorry. Man, I don't know why you guys continue to be here with those kind of jokes. Just kidding. Tonight's message is called Breaking Busy. Like I said last week, we're kind of playing off TV programs. They're all starting up again. Once again, don't say, you watch that show? No, I don't. I just Googled top shows, and that was one of them. So Breaking Bad, Breaking Busy. How many of you guys feel like sometimes you get just too busy? Yeah, me too. Just too much stuff going on. You often feel run down. You often feel like, man, where does the time go? Man, is it already 9 o'clock? I got to go to bed. I got to wake up early. And we just go, and our lives are just passing us by. So how do we break busy? How do we live lives and manage our time properly? How do we go through our lives and figure out what it is that we should be spending our time on? How do we wake up in the morning, have purpose in our lives, know that there's a plan for the day, and know that things are going to get accomplished? How many of you guys have to-do lists? Anybody have to-do lists? Okay. Okay, I'm going to see how sick you guys really are. It's like me, all right? How many of you guys who do a to-do list, if you do something that's not on your to-do list, you write it on there just so you can scratch it off? Anybody else? Yes, me too. I love that. I'm like, no, I did this. I'm writing it. Shoot. Yes. Got it done. Time management. It's a big problem today. It seems like Remember when, hey, you know, computers and technology, it's going to, man, we're going to have so much time on our hands, right? Boy, was that a lie. Breaking busy. So how do we, what is the code to breaking busy? Tonight we're going to talk about the code to breaking busy. Number one, and you're going to have to bear with me after I tell you what number one is. The code, number one thing in a code is self-evaluation. Self-evaluation. Jesus said this in Matthew chapter 7, verse 3. Jesus said, "And why worry about a speck in your friend's eye when you have a log in your own? How can you think of saying to your friend, 'Let me help you get rid of that speck in your eye,' when you can't see past the log in your own eye?" Hypocrite! That's right. You see an exclamation mark? Hypocrite! First, get rid of the log in your own eye. Then you will see well enough to deal with the speck in your friend's eye. Now, Jesus is actually kind of having fun right here. He's actually being a little humorous. So I'll give you an example. Brad, come on up here, buddy. I need a volunteer that I can maybe hurt. So
this wasn't planned.
Yeah, this wasn't planned. I just like, okay, who can I hurt? They have to love me anyway. Brad, of course. All right. So what Jesus is saying here is this is the scenario. Hey, Brad. No, come here. Look, you got this annoying speck in your... Hey, you guys, can't you see that annoying speck? No, right here, look. It's like right here in his eye. Can you see it? No, look real close. You can see it. Isn't he annoying? Isn't he just obnoxious looking with that speck in his eye? Okay, you can sit down. You didn't hurt your bad dog. Jesus is having a little fun here, saying... He's not saying, look, you got like a little splinter in your eye, and they just got a speck. Hey, you got like a little stick or a twig. No, Jesus is saying you have a plank, is what the word is, a plank, like a log. You're going around knocking people over with this obnoxious plank coming out of your eyeball, and yet you're going to go and talk about this person doing this and this person doing that and this person doing this. So the first thing in the code to breaking busy is this. Don't be, I can't say that in church. I'm going to hurt someone's feelings. Should I say it anyway?
Yeah.
Raise your hand if you want me to say it. Majority wins. Don't be a busybody. Hey, sit down. Stop walking out. Where does the term busybody come from? You're so busy looking at everybody else that you're not focusing on yourself. And you're being a busybody. Why are you so busy? Why don't you have any time? Because you may be a busybody. You're focusing on what everyone else is doing rather than looking at yourself. My wife and I like to watch programs, but it's really hard to find a program these days. Anybody with me? Where there's not sketchy stuff going on, right? So we found a show that we like to watch called Alone. People are isolated completely by themselves or even recording. They're filming themselves. There's no cameramen or women there. How sketchy can it get, right? There's some language that they bleep it all out. So we're watching this show called Alone. And these people are totally by themselves. And I love it because you can see people's minds start to go. People start getting cray-cray when they're by themselves too much. And so there's this one guy, he goes on there and he says, "Yeah, I'm on here and I really need to work on some things. You know, my wife and I have talked, there's some things I need to work on in my life and I've got anger issues. You know, I get angry real easily and there's some areas in my life where I really want to discover myself during this trip. And I want to fix these things and work on these things." So this guy is taking some supplies up a hill. He's climbing up a hill, and he's kind of like got a little, you know, stinky attitude to begin with. As he's climbing, you can hear him going, "Man, this terrain is..." And then he goes, and you hear, "Beep, beep, 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 beep." And he goes, "See this rock right here? Stupid rock. If it wasn't for this rock, I wouldn't have fallen down if I think I might have broke bleep, my lip, bleep, the bleep, 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 bleep. Rock. And I'm thinking, bro, you got more than anger issues. Let me tell you that. And I remember thinking to myself, man, you're going to even blame a rock for your dysfunction. There's no one else around here I can blame, right? Because he couldn't even eat anything because he couldn't find any squirrels. So there's no squirrels. There's no animate object to blame. So I'm going to find a slippery rock. A stupid rock. If it wasn't for this rock, I wouldn't have broke my leg and I wouldn't have hurt myself and I wouldn't have fell down a hill. A stupid rock. Imagine what your life would look like if other people's, if your expectation of other people weren't there. Imagine how much less stress you would have on your life if your expectation of other people, or rocks, wasn't there. How much anxiety do you have in your life? How many problems do you have in your life because of unmet expectations from other people? I would argue for myself, a lot. I'm going to speak for myself. This point right here just hit me all upside the head this week because I spend way too much time thinking about other people and worrying about helping to change them and why won't they do this and how come they get, rather than just focusing on moi. Imagine what this world would look like if every person, every one of us, would just self-evaluate and say, okay, God, what do I need to change about me? What would happen if we just stopped and said, you know what? Maybe he's not the problem. Maybe she's not the problem. Maybe them and that and this and those and that. Maybe it's me. Maybe it starts and ends with number one. What would it look like? What would it look like? How much more time would we have on our hands if we would stop, self-evaluate, look at ourselves, and what we can change about ourselves? Because I find that I spend a lot more time thinking about how messed up other people are than I do about how messed up I am. Maybe I'm just alone because you guys are out there going, All right. Number two, the code to breaking busy. Get your priorities straight. Luke chapter 12, great story. Luke chapter 12, verse 13 says this. Then someone called from the crowd. Let me stop for a second. So Jesus is talking. It says thousands of people came to hear Jesus teach. And Jesus is saying things like, hey, listen, these guys, these people, don't worry about other people. Don't worry about the worldly stuff. Don't worry, all these people can do, the worst thing that anybody can do on this planet is kill you. You should fear God, you know why? Because he can kill you and send you to hell. It's the red letters, it's in there. And Jesus is talking to these people, stop worrying about other people, stop, just focus on God. Pretty soon, it's going to come, and you guys are going to see it, and you're going to see that, man, this, the Son of Man, that's Jesus, we talked about a few weeks ago, Jesus, you're going to see that the Son of Man is here, and if you deny me before God, I will deny you before God. That's pretty harsh teaching, isn't it? So then this guy comes in, I'm going to call him a knucklehead, because he kind of sounds like a knucklehead. Then someone called from the crowd, teacher, over here, yo, Jesus. Oh, not this guy again, yeah. Teacher, please tell my brother to divide our father's estate with me. Can you imagine Jesus? So Jesus replied, friend, who made me a judge over you to decide such things as that? Then he said, beware, guard against every kind of greed. Life is not measured by how much you own. Then he told them a story. Troy, why do you always teach with stories? Well, because Jesus did. A rich man had a fertile farm that produced fine crops. He said to himself, what should I do? I don't have enough room for all my crops. And he said, I know, I'll tear down my barns and build bigger ones. Then I'll have room enough to store all my wheat and other goods. And I'll sit back and say to myself, my friend, you have enough stored away for years to come. Now take it easy, eat, drink, and be merry. But God said to him, you fool, you will die this very night. Then who will get everything you work for? Yes, a person is a fool to store up earthly wealth but not have a rich relationship with God. Man, is Jesus cool or what? Isn't he just like, wouldn't you like to just be there for one of those times and you just sit back going, ooh, yeah, he got you. Shut up. He got you last week. I know, but he got you this week. Get your priorities straight. One of my favorite sayings is this: good is the enemy of best. Good is the enemy of best. In your life, most of the time, you're not going to have to decide between best and bad, right? You're not going to say, man, you know, should I date my wife or should I rob a bank? Right? No, it's going to be, should I date my wife or should I work a little bit longer tonight to make more money? I mean, that's good, right? We want responsible. Everybody likes the do-re-mi, right? That's good. But dating your wife is best. Better. Close enough, honey. Here's a story. Charles Francis Adams, grandson of John Adams and son of John Quincy Adams. Figure that one out. Served as a Massachusetts state senator, a U.S. congressman, and an ambassador to Great Britain under Abraham Lincoln. He was also very conscientious about keeping a daily journal and encouraged his children to do the same. Henry Brooks, fourth of seven children, followed his advice and began journaling as a young age. A particular entry written when Brooks was eight, has continued to catch our attention following a day spent with his father. He wrote, went fishing with my father today, the most glorious day of my life. This day was so glorious, in fact, that Brooks continued to talk and write about that particular day for the next 30 years. It was then that Brooks thought to compare journal entries with his father. For that day, Charles, his father, had written, went fishing with my son, a day wasted. Now it's possible that Charles was upset that they didn't came home and they didn't catch any fish, it says. It's very possible, but oftentimes things get in the way in our lives that keep us from the best things. I don't think there's one person in this room who's going to be laying on their deathbed and saying to themselves, dang it, I wish I would have spent more time in the office. Man, I wish I would have just worked more overtime. I guarantee you, every one of us is going to be thinking about relationships. Relationships. Get your priorities straight. The thing that we should be spending the most of our time on is our family and the people that we love. In our home, we have gone on trips and we have done things, but those aren't the things that really come up in the highlight reel. There are always times when we're sitting around doing nothing, being silly, when we just start laughing and laughing and laughing, and those are the times. Those are the times that we talk about. Those are the times that we cherish. So you might be thinking, well, you know, you got to make a lot of money so you can take your family on vacation. No, it's not really about that. It's more about quantity, more so than quality. And what I mean by that is oftentimes we look at big vacations and we look at these things where you know, these are quality times I spent with my children where we went on this big thing and we took the kids and we went in there. They'll never forget that. No. It's the everyday things. It's the being there all the time. Now, I'm not saying that quality time does not matter. You want to spend quality time with your children and with your family. However, it's the quantity. It's the being there every day, being there for them, just sitting with them, just talking with them, doing the things that families love to do. I'm going to encourage us to look at our time and budget it as if it were money. Imagine if we treated our time like we do our money, most of us. If you're here tonight and you don't have a budget for your finances, please do so. It's very important that you have a budget, that you keep a budget. You should also budget your time. It's important that you know what you're spending your time on. It's important that you schedule things. It's important that you make time to do the things that are important in your life. Next thing is, this is the hardest thing for most of us to do in this room, is to think next thing to breaking the code to breaking busy is learn to say no. Learn to say no. Matthew 5, verse 33 through 37 says this. Now, this is part of Jesus' greatest sermon. It's called a Sermon on the Mount. Jesus is teaching about divorce. Jesus is teaching about finances. Jesus is teaching about all these things. He's, blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are those who are poor. Blessed is Jesus' most famous sermon. And in the middle of this, he has this in here. It says, you have also heard that our ancestors were told, you must not break your vows. You must carry out the vows you make to the Lord. But I say, do not make any vows. Do not say, by heaven, because heaven is God's throne. And do not say, by the earth, because the earth is his footstool. And do not say, by Jerusalem, for Jerusalem is the city of the great king. Do not even say, by my head, for you can't turn one hair white or black. Just say a simple yes, I will, or no, I won't. Anything beyond this is from the evil one. Isn't that crazy? It's like you think of the Sermon on the Mount and all these things and the Beatitudes and all this stuff of the Sermon on the Mount in Matthew 5. And all of a sudden, Jesus is talking about saying yes. You let your yes be yes and your no be no. Well, it's because we don't know how to say no. Think about it. Somebody comes to you and says, hey, can you help me move on such and such date? And you're busy and you've got stuff going on in your life and your calendar is full and you need some rest time. And so you can just say, no. Does anyone do that? I don't know anyone who does that. I see people who do this. Can you help me move on Saturday? Oh, no. U-M-M-M-M-M-M-M. That's Sorry, I can't. I have to rearrange my sock drawer that day. Just kidding. Right? It's no, I, sorry, I can't because. And sometimes we end up maybe telling a fib. Not anyone in here because you guys are all good Christians, but bad Christians will tell a fib and say, oh, sorry, I'm already busy that day, right? Why can't we just say no? Hey, Scott, can you come over next week and can you help me move my refrigerator? Yeah. Let's try this side of the room. Let's see, who will play along? Oh, I know this guy. Hey, Jamie, since you're leaving, hey, can you help me move my refrigerator this weekend?
Heck no.
Okay, don't put the heck in front of it. All right, the sermon did not call for a heck. Heck no was not part, just no, right? Why is it so hard for us as human beings just to say No, listen, I'm going to tell you something here that might set you free, okay? Saying no is okay. Hey, can you help out with this church function coming up? You can't say no to that. You'll go to hell for sure. Right? I mean, someone's asking you to do something for the Lord. You got to say yes to that, right? No. No. No is okay. Listen, if you tell somebody no, and they get angry with you, that is their problem, not your problem. Don't be codependent on people. If they're angry with you just because you said no, then you love them. You're not angry with them. And when they're over there, can you say they're having a pity party in church? Is that okay? When they're over their pity party, and then you just accept them, and you don't have to say, why'd you get so mad at me? Jeez. You just say, hey, welcome back. Welcome back to the dependent, right? Not codependent, dependent, I don't know, right? Welcome back to the world of normal people, right? And I'm sorry you were, no, forget, see what I just did? Oh, I'm sorry you were angry. No, I'm not. I'm not sorry you were angry. That's on you. It's okay to say no. The reason why we get so busy oftentimes is because we can't say no. And you know where the hardest part of it is? In church. We have a really hard time in church saying no. I was really proud of our church because I asked like 20 people, hey, we need help in children's ministry. I asked like 20 people and 15 of you go, nope. And I'm like, good for you. And guess what I did? I went, did you just say no? I'll pray for you. No, guess what I said? You know what I said? Okay. Thank you. And guess what? I see him now and I go, hi. And they say, hi. I say, how you doing? And they say, great. I was like, awesome. Yeah. It's fine. No is fine. And the five people who said yes, I'm like, you're so much better Christians. And I'm just kidding. I'm kidding. I'm playing around. Of course not. The five people said, you know what the five people said? They said, you know what? I would love to do that. I've been thinking about that. Because guess what? If you put somebody who hates children in children's ministry, it's never going to end well. Say no. Yeah, you let your yes be yes and your no be no. I thought about this. I had to write it down because this really spoke to me. Bless you. Oh, we say no with an explanation, and we say yes with proof. We say no with an explanation. No, I gotta. No, I think I might have to. Let me pray about it. Right? That when we say let me pray about it, it's so you can think of a good excuse, right? Or we say yes with an explanation. Hey, did you really go to that? Yeah, I went. I got a stub. I got a ticket stub here somewhere. I can prove I was there. It was like, whoa, dude, I just asked you a question, right? We always have to say yes with proof or no with an explanation. Jesus is saying, listen, you don't have to swear by yourself. I swear that I'm. Jesus said, don't say that. Don't say that. Just say no. Just say yes. I mean, if you're a person who's an honest person, you shouldn't have anything to worry about, right? Oftentimes what happens is we get ourselves in trouble because we say no with a lie behind it. You would have been fine with just the no, but now you lied, and now you have to remember the lie you told. Hey, how was that thing you went to last week? Oh, what thing? Oh, yeah, that was awesome. You're lying, right? Just say no. Just say yes. How hard is that? Is it hard? Is it just me? Are we going to get better at that as a church, as a people? Can we start here just saying, you know what? I love you, but no. No, not even I love you. Forget that. No. I mean, do it nicely. No. Do it with a smile. No. the last thing. This whole message has convicted me all week long, but this one right here is the one that got me the most. The last thing is take time to be still. Psalm 46, verse 10 is a popular verse. We're going to add verse 11 tonight. Psalm 46, 10 and 11 says this. Be still and know that I am God. I will be honored by every nation. I will be honored throughout the world. The Lord of heaven's armies, we'll say the Lord of the heaven's armies is here among us. The Lord of Israel is our fortress. Let me ask you a question. It's going to be very probably convicting because it was very convicting for me. When is the last time you sat in complete silence with no electronics, no radio, no TV? Well, it wouldn't be silent if there was no radio TV, but you get my drift. Nothing. No Bible, just you and God. Nothing. Just silence. Nothing. Kind of creepy, huh? Silence can be deafening sometimes, can't it? We're so busy. We have so much stuff going on in our lives. For us just to sit and to be still is so hard for us to do. Put that scripture up on the screen again, please, tech team. The Lord of the heaven's army is here among us. The Lord of Israel is our fortress. The Lord of the heaven's armies is here among us. The Lord of the heaven's armies. Think about that. You guys ever seen like an army, like people just marching like an army, like soldiers? And how cool it is. They're in unison. They're just like tough. They got stuff and guns and they're buff. I don't know if they're buffed or not. They look buffed, right? You ever seen just like they're all lined up in a big row and saluting and you're like, man, those guys are cool, right? Think about that. Now think about the Lord of the heavens armies. Think about the heavens armies. Oh, you know all those guys are yoked, right? I mean, there's no wimpy angels. I'm sorry. You know, hey, guys, can I? No, God did not create any wimpy angels, right? Lord of the heaven's armies is here among us. The Lord of the heaven's armies is here among us. And all we have to do to be in touch with him is to sit and to be still and meditate on him. You know, meditation gets a bad rap, right? We think of meditation, we think some weird going thing, right? Did you know that meditation is mentioned over 70 times in the Bible? You know, David talks about meditating on God all the time. Do you realize that in the Old Testament, which is more than, you know, most of this, right? All that, did you know that they didn't have Bibles? I mean, you couldn't like take your backpack out, feed the sheep, pop it open the King James Version and start reading. It didn't work like that. You were there. David was there among sheep. David was there in silence. David was there with nothing but stars, wind, air, and God. And some, probably some stinky smells, but you get the point. Right? Just sitting and meditating on God. And then the last part of that verse says that he's our fortress. We have to be able to take advantage of that fortress that God provides for us. The way we take advantage of that fortress, see, we can say, yeah, our God is a mighty fortress, right? And you can say, there it is over there. But you got to get in. What good is a Ford if you're sitting outside? The army's coming. Uh-oh. Well, there's a Ford, but I don't have a key. I can't get in the fort because I don't know God. I don't know how to tap into the Lord. I don't know how to tap in to God. Well, let me tell you, we make it a lot harder than it really needs to be. It's simply sitting and meditating and knowing that the Lord of the heaven's armies is here. Now, it's hard for us because oftentimes I think we pray and we pray with God. I'm going to challenge you. Pray this way. Pray as if God was sitting right next to you. Get away to a place where there's no one else around, where there's no distractions, and nobody can hear you. Find a place like that where you can get away and you can talk to God audibly. When's the last time you spoke to God audibly? When's the last time you sat and you just got in his presence and you just spoke to God like you're speaking to your friend? And I'm going to encourage you, do less of this and do more of this. You say, God, Troy, God doesn't ever talk to me. Listen, God has never spoken to me audibly. I think he is. I'm waiting for it. I'm hoping someday. I'm sitting there. I believe, I mean, God can do anything. I love God, and I love spending time with him. I love talking to him. I talk a lot, and I listen not as much as I talk, I just to be honest, right? But I'm waiting for one day where I'm just sitting there, I'm saying, God, I just love you so much. You're so awesome, God. I just worship you. You're so beautiful. I love you, too. I love you so much, God. I love you, too, Troy. I'm waiting. I'm waiting. I want it to happen. God can do it. But how many times, how often do we get so busy in our lives that we find ourselves days, weeks, months, and we haven't spent any time with God? And then we sit there and we say, man, I don't understand why my life is the way it is. Trust me, guys, I'm not trying to make you feel bad because this convicted me this week as well. But you sit there and you say, why is my life the way it is? Why am I depressed? Why am I sad? Why can't I get along with my spouse? Why are my children? Why? And God is saying, hey, hello. Here I am. Here I am. And guess what? I'm not just some thing in the clouds. I'm the Lord of the heaven's armies. I can go to battle for you. Cast all your cares on me. Amen. Yeah, you know that big burden you're carrying around? Stop it. Yeah. Here's what I think we do. I think most of the time we spend with God is worrying. Oh, I mean praying. I think it's worrying. God, please help my finances to go well. God, please help us have money to pay for bills. God, help my children. God, help my husband. God help. Worry, anxiety. And God is saying, hey, just give it to me. Stop it. What would happen if we just said, God, you know what? There's that fortress. I'm tapping into that. Because you know why? The Lord of the heaven's armies is here. And I'm going to rely on that. Oh, God, I just need peace. I know I've given it to you already. Receive it. Don't ever pray for peace. God's given it to you. Read it. It's in there. Jesus said, my peace I leave with you. I've come so you can have joy and have it abundantly. Listen, we should be the most obnoxiously happy people in the world. I mean, you ever find yourself just smiling for no reason? I just sit there. I'm just walking around. I'm like, just smiling because I'm just thinking about God. I'm thinking about how great he is. I'm just like, yeah. Oh, I look kind of weird right now. Listen, the Lord... I'm going to say this over and over again until someone gets this. The Lord of the heaven's armies is here. He's here. Tap into that. You're not distracting him. You're like, oh, God doesn't have, no, God's got time for you. You are the most important thing to him. You are the apple of his eye. The Lord of the heaven's armies is with you. Let me ask you, what are you going to do different this week? We heard a good message, and well, hopefully it's a good message. Pat yourself in the back, dude, really. We heard a message. We read the Bible. We've been challenged by God's word, hopefully, right? So what are we going to do? Oh, that was awesome. What do you want to eat tonight? Or are we going to change something this week? Because guess what? The only way that anything is going to change is if we change it. And that goes back to point number one, self-evaluation. Just pray, ask God, Lord, what do you want? What do you want from me? Where do you? I need to change? Show me. I want to be the man or the woman that you've created me to be. Everyone bow your heads and close your eyes. One of the things that's impossible to do is to tap into God or to rely on God if you don't have a relationship with him. Michelle, can I have a little bit of light, please? Thank you. I want everyone just to sit for just a minute. Everyone just close your eyes. And I want you to think about your relationship with God. And I'm going to pray two prayers tonight. If you're here tonight, your relationship with God is stagnant. I'm going to pray that God, you and God, will come together this week and this year like you never have before. I'm going to pray that for you tonight. If you're here tonight and your relationship with God is non-existent, tonight is your night. Tonight is a night that God has called you. Tonight is a night that God has called you to be here. You're not here by accident. So every head bowed, every eye closed, I'm going to pray a prayer. And if you're here tonight, you've never received Jesus Christ as your personal Savior. At the end of that prayer, I'm going to ask you just to slip your hand up. Look me in the eye and put your hand back down, because you will never be able to tap in to the Lord of the heaven's armies if he's not your Lord and Savior. So every head bowed, every eye closed, everyone repeat this prayer after me. Lord Jesus, I admit that I've sinned against you. And I believe with all my heart that you died on the cross for my sins. I believe with all my heart that you rose from the dead on the third day. And I believe with all my heart that you're going to come again. And I commit my life to you from this day forward. With every head bowed and every eye closed, if you prayed that prayer for the first time and you meant it, I want you just to look me in the eye, put your hand up, and then put your hand back down. I'll wait just a moment. Just look at me, put your hand up, and put your hand back down. Anybody, I'll wait just a minute. It's the most important day of your life. If you've never received Jesus Christ as your Savior, tonight is your night. Anybody? And if you're here tonight and you're ready to take that step and you're ready to tap in to the Lord of the heaven's armies and you've never done that before, and if your relationship with God is a little bit stale, I'm going to ask you right now just to lift your hand up and look me in the eye. Just lift your hand up. Yes, ma'am. Anybody else? Yes, yes. Anybody else? Yes. Your relationship with God is just, yes, just so right now. And you want to tap in and you want to spend more time. Anybody else? I'll wait just a moment. Yes, sir. Yes, ma'am. Yes, sir. Yes, ma'am. Yes, sir. God, I pray for every person, yes, sir, every person, yes, ma'am. I pray for every person here tonight that raised their hand and is ready to tap in to the Lord of the heaven's armies. God, I think that every person in this room, every one of us could raise our hand tonight. Every one of us could say, God, we need you more. We need more of you. And so I pray for those specifically that raise their hands, God, that you would be real to them. I pray, Father, that they would spend time with you, that they would seek you. Your word says that if we seek you, that we will find you. So I pray, Father, that each person in this room will turn their focus away from themselves and their issues and their problems and turn their eyes towards you, their Savior, the Lord of the heaven's armies. God, we love you. We praise you. We thank you for the gift of life. In Jesus' name, amen.